Hello everyone, welcome back to my class. This is Rumana Ali. I hope you all are doing well. In today's class, I'm going to explain you about the chapter Photosynthesis in Higher Plants. So we all know that photosynthesis is a process by which the plants prepare their own food by utilizing the sunlight, water and carbon dioxide. And in this chapter, we are going to discuss about the historical background. That means the different scientists that gave the different ideas about the process of photosynthesis, and even we are going to learn about the light and the dark reaction that takes place in the process of photosynthesis. Okay, so let us first discuss about the historical background. So here the scientist named Van Helmont, he was the scientist who gave an idea that food comes from water, not from soil. So he did an experiment. In his experiment, he took a potted plant. Then he measured the mass of the soil and also the mass of the plant. So he take as x mass of plant and y as a mass of soil. Now after measuring the mass of the plant and the mass of the soil, he watered that potted plant for few days. Then after a few days, he again measured the mass of the plant and even the mass of the soil. So when he measured the mass, then he observed that the mass of the plant increases twice and thrice, but the change in the mass of the soil is negligible. There is no change in the mass of the soil. So based on that observation, he gave the statement that the plants get the food from water. They can prepare the food with water, but they cannot get their food from soil. So this was the statement given by Van Helmont. Now the next one is Joseph Priestley. He said that plant restore air, whatever breathing animals and burning candle removes. He also did one experiment, and based on the observation, he gave this idea. So in his experiment, he took bell jars and also he took one candle, a rat and even a potted plant. Now what he did? He burned the candle and invert the bell jar on it. That means he put the bell jar in an inverted manner on that candle. Now when he closed that candle with the bell jar, the candle puts off. It stops burning. In the same way, when he keep the mouse in that bell jar, in a shorter period of time, the mouse felt sophisticated in that closed environment, and he also became too weak and he died. Now what he did, he put a potted plant along with the burning candle and a rat, and he observed that no one is getting affected by closing it with the bell jar. Even after closing them with the bell jar, they can easily survive. The candle is burning continuously, the rat is breathing normally, and even the plant is also fresh. So by this observation, he concluded that whatever the gas which is released by the burning candle is consumed by the plant, and in turn the gas released by the plants is consumed by the animals in that burning candle. Now we know that for burning candle oxygen is required, and even for the animals to breathe, the oxygen is required. Now carbon dioxide is required for the plants to prepare the photosynthesis. So during exhalation, the animals, and even after the burning, the candle, after burning also, the carbon dioxide is a gas which is released. So the carbon dioxide which is produced or which is released by the burning candle and by the rat is consumed by the plants, and that plants, when they prepare the food, they releases oxygen as a byproduct, and that oxygen is consumed or it is utilized by the animals or that burning candle. So in the presence of oxygen only, the candle can burn. So this was an experiment done by Joseph Priestley, and based on that experiment only he gave this statement. The next one is Jan Inges Hoss. He was a scientist who described that the sunlight is an essential factor in the process of photosynthesis. And the next one is Julius von Sack. He said that the plants produce glucose during the process of photosynthesis. The plants, they use water, they use sunlight, and also use carbon dioxide to prepare their food, and that food is present in the form of glucose, and this glucose can be converted into starch and it is stored in the plants. The next is T.W. Engelmann. He was a scientist who did an experiment with green algae. He took green algae. So in his experiment, he took an aquatic medium, and in this aquatic medium, he put green algae and he exposed this green algae to the different wavelengths. Now, we know that the visible light, it is scattered into 7 colors, vibgyor. So, when he exposed this green algae to these wavelengths, then he saw that this green algae, it is accumulating more where the blue and the red light is present. So, in the blue and the red region, the green algae is accumulating more. And in this region only, we can find the presence of, or we can see the bubbles. The bubbles are coming in the water medium in the blue as well as in the red region. So, this indicates that the oxygen is released by the green algae. And we know that oxygen is released only after performing photosynthesis. Oxygen is a byproduct of photosynthesis. So, here by this observation, we can understand that blue and the red region are more suitable for the green algae to perform photosynthesis. Next is Van Niel. He was a scientist who did an experiment by using purple and green color bacteria, and he gave an idea about light reaction and dark reaction. He demonstrated about the two types of reaction that are very essential in photosynthesis. The photosynthesis is a process that can be completed by two types of reaction, that is light reaction and dark reaction. Light reaction means light dependent reaction, and dark reaction is light independent reaction. So, in this chapter, we are going to discuss about the light and the dark reaction in detail. Okay. Next is Robert Hale. He was a scientist who gave an idea that light energy, which is trapped by the plants, can be used to generate reducing power. This also we are going to learn in detail afterwards. And Emerson was a scientist who have demonstrated about photosystem 1, photosystem 2 and Emerson's effect. Melvin Kelvin was a scientist who gave the description about the C3 cycle, which is also called as dark reaction. So, in this lesson, photosynthesis in higher plants, we are going to discuss about all these things in detail. Now, we are going to learn about the site of photosynthesis. We all know that green plants are able to perform photosynthesis. Green leaves are the major sites where the process of photosynthesis takes place. So, when we look at the internal structure of the leaf, then we can find an outer layer, or we can call it as an upper epidermis. And this upper epidermis is covered with cuticle. So, this one is upper epidermis and it is covered with cuticle. And cuticle is a layer which prevents the water loss. Now, beneath the upper epidermis, and the internal structure of the leaf also shows the presence of lower epidermis, and in the lower epidermis some pores are present which are called as stomata. So, stomata are the pores that are present in the lower epidermal layer of leaf, and these stomata are guarded by the guard cell and they help in the processes like transpiration and exchange of gases. So, this is stomata, and here this one is lower epidermis, and in between we can find the presence of vascular bundles. Vascular bundles contains the tissues called xylem and phloem, and the function of xylem and phloem is they help in transportation. Xylem helps in transporting the water and the minerals, and phloem helps in the transportation of food material. So, xylem and phloem together can be called as vascular bundle, which is present in the leaves. And beneath the upper epidermis, some compactly arranged parenchymatous cells are present. And these compactly arranged parenchymatous cells are called as pallid parenchyma. So, beneath the upper epidermis, some parenchymatous cells are compactly arranged, and these compactly arranged parenchymatous cells are called as pallid parenchyma. And beneath these, some loosely packed parenchymatous cells are present, which are called as spongy parenchyma. Now the cells which are present in the middle part of the leaf, they are termed as mesophyll cells. So this is the internal structure of leaf where we can find the upper epidermis and lower epidermis. Upper epidermis is covered with a layer called cuticle which prevents the water loss, and lower epidermis contains some pores that are called as stomata, and stomata are the structures that helps in different processes like in transpiration and also in the respiration. In the middle, or where the veins of the leaf cut, there we can find the presence of vascular bundles. Vascular bundle means presence of xylem tissues and phloem tissues. So these vascular tissues helps in the transportation of food material as well as in the transportation of water and minerals. And we can find the presence of two types of parenchymatous cells. One is compactly arranged, which are known as pallucid parenchyma, and the other one is loosely arranged parenchymatous cells, and they are known as spongy parenchyma. Pallucid and spongy parenchyma both together can be called as mesophyll cells. So this is about the internal structure of the leaf. Now let us enlarge one mesophyll cell. So when we enlarge the structure of mesophyll cell, we can find, so in the mesophyll cell, a large vacuole is present, a nucleus is present, and chloroplast is also present. So let us see what are the structures that we can find in the chloroplast. So in the chloroplast, first the chloroplast is double membrane organelle. Two membranes are present, double membranous structure, and this inside the chloroplast, it is filled with some jelly-like material, and this jelly-like substance which is present in the inner membrane of the chloroplast, it can be called as stroma. Now inside this stroma, some membranous structures are present that stacks over one another, and these structures are called as granum. One such stack or one such membranous structure can be termed as thylakoid, and the whole stack is termed as granum. Only one stack is called as thylakoid, one membranous structure is called as thylakoid. Okay, now these thylakoids or these granums, they are attached to one another with some more membranous structure. These are called as stroma lamellae. Okay, so they are interconnected with each other through membranous structures which are called as stroma lamellae, and inside the chloroplast, its own ribosomes and DNA is also present. So DNA and ribosomes is also present in the chloroplast. Now let us see what are the different parts that we can find in the structure of chloroplast. So when we look at the internal structure of chloroplast, the first thing is it is double membrane organelle, that means the two membranes are present, and inside it is filled with some jelly-like material that is called as stroma. Now in the stroma, we can find the presence of some membranous structures which are stacked over one another, and that collectively known as granum. But one such membrane is called as thylakoid, and these membranous structure which are called as granum, they are interconnected with stroma lamellae. And in the chloroplast, we can also find the presence of DNA and ribosomes. Now where the pigments are present that are responsible or that are involved in the process of photosynthesis. So these pigments, in the lower classes you might have studied about the chlorophyll pigment, and this chlorophyll pigment is very essential for the process of photosynthesis. So where it is found, where is the site of this chlorophyll pigment? So when we enlarge the structure of one thylakoid, then it is also a membranous structure. Outer and the inner membrane we can find, and here we can see the green color pigments which are called as chlorophyll pigments. So this is about the site of photosynthesis. The main site of photosynthesis is green leaf, and inside the green leaf, some mesophyll cells are present. Inside the mesophyll cell, chloroplast is present, and in this chloroplast, the different structure is present like thylakoid, and in this thylakoid, the green color pigments are present which helps in the process of photosynthesis, and that green color pigments are nothing but chlorophyll pigment. So in the beginning I told you that photosynthesis is a process that can be completed in two reactions, that is light reaction and dark reaction. So the pigments which are present in the thylakoid, they absorb light, and after the absorption of light only the light reaction takes place. So the site of light reaction is thylakoid and the site of dark reaction is stroma. Stroma, the inner jelly like fluid of chloroplast. Okay, so the site of dark reaction is stroma and the site of light reaction is thylakoid, because in the thylakoid the pigments are present which absorbs the light, and they are going to start the light reaction. After absorption only the light reaction will start. That's all for today. Meet you next class. Thank you.